Welcome to Lossie Mouth Baptist Church.
Well, good evening, everyone.
With all this talk of storms, you would think there's a storm coming. So I've just checked on my phone, so it's due soon, but we'll hopefully get out and home before then.
I thought about this passage a wee while back, and I'd spoken about it some years ago, and then it was covered when we went through Mark. But there was just something about it as I read through it. So I was reading through Mark's Gospel a couple of weeks ago, and something just struck me about it, and I thought, I'll just focus on that, because I think Jesus is asking us questions here. And when you're mentoring or coaching someone, quite often you don't tell them what to do. You get them to work out what to do themselves by asking them questions. So how did that go? Could you have done that better? How would you do it the next time? You know, things like that, when you're sort of looking after folks and coaching them and when they're in difficult situations. So it's Mark 4 and verse 35, and it says this. On the same day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us cross over to the other side." Now, when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and other little boats were also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" Then he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. But he said to them, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, "Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this event in the life of Jesus and the disciples that's recorded by Mark. We thank you for the power and the authority that Jesus showed here, but we thank you also that he has given us something to think about the fear that we often feel and about the fact that we sometimes don't exercise our faith in the way that we should. We have faith, we have saving faith in Christ, but we need to exercise that faith. And thank you that as we come to think about this tonight, that you will speak into our hearts. Oh God, please speak into our hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I suppose we could re-paraphrase it and have Jesus saying to them, "Do you not trust me?" Now, I would suggest that if a fisherman in a boat are terrified, most folk in a boat would be terrified with them because they would know the conditions. So they were terrified. But Jesus says to them, "Why are you so fearful? Why are you so full of fear?" Because they must have been in storms like this before at some point, I suspect. "And how is it you have no faith?" And obviously the faith is in him. And he's saying to them, "Do you not trust me?" And I suppose he's saying that to us tonight. Do we not trust him? How much do we trust God in our lives? You know, is it just a sort of a Sunday thing? Is it a Monday thing? But by the time it gets to Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, there's a few hassles in our lives. We kind of maybe feel the trust ebbing away. Or is it something that we do hold on to and we do sustain and we do have positively in our lives? And there's various reasons, I think, that we don't trust God if we come along to church. I suppose the first reason would be that maybe we're not born of the Spirit. And that's quite a thing to say. But if you look at, churches and you speak to people in churches, as many of us have done, right across the denominational spectrum, some people you speak to, they just aren't born of the Spirit. You know, they believe Jesus might forgive their sins. They believe they might get to heaven. They believe the Bible, more or less. But they haven't come into that point of revelation where God has revealed to them that their sins actually are forgiven. They do not actually know that they're definitely going to heaven. They're a bit like Nicodemus, who when he came to Jesus, you know, Jesus said to him, "You must be born of the Spirit, born anew." The way I like it to be expressed is born from above. In other words, God does something in your heart. You can't do it, neither can I. So he says to Nicodemus, you must be born from above. So maybe here tonight, I don't know, because I don't know everybody, but maybe here tonight you feel fear sometimes and you feel a lack of faith, maybe because you don't have faith, because you're not born of the Spirit. You've never come to that point where you said, "Right, Jesus, I want you to come into my life. I want you to forgive my sins." And maybe that's because you feel you don't need to do that. Maybe because you're a good person. And, you know, most people are quite good. But God's looking for a perfection in you and I that we cannot have ourselves to get into heaven. And only Jesus can do that for us. And I read this a wee while back. In fact, it's on my birthday, this reading. So maybe it's speaking to me more than anybody else. It's quite pertinent. And it's this, Spurgeon writes this. And it's talking about people and how an honest confession. Just being honest with God. Whether you're a Christian tonight or not, honesty with God's a good thing. And Spurgeon quotes from Job chapter 33, he says this, "He looks upon men and women, and if any say, I have sinned and perverted that which was right, and it profits me not, he will deliver his soul from going into the pit, and his life shall see the light." So that's anybody, that's open to anybody at all. And that was written thousands and thousands of years ago. And this is what Spurgeon says about it. "This is a word of truth, gathered from the experience of a man of God, and it is tantamount to a promise. What the Lord has done and is doing, he will continue to do while the world stands. The Lord will receive into his bosom all who come to him with a sincere confession of their sin." You just have to say, yeah, I've sinned. It's quite simple. "In fact, he is always on the lookout to discover any that are in trouble because of their faults. Can we not endorse the language here used? Have we not sinned? Sinned personally, so as to say, I have sinned? Sinned willfully, having perverted that which is right? Sinned so as to discover that there is no profit in this sin, but an eternal loss. Let us then go to God with this honest acknowledgement. He asks no more, we can do more less. We can do no less. Let us plead his promise in the name of Jesus. He will deliver us from the pit of hell which yawns for us. He will grant us light and life. Why should we despair? Why should we even doubt? The Lord will not mock humble souls. He means what he says. The guilty can be forgiven. Those who deserve execution can receive free pardon. Lord, we confess, and we ask you to forgive us." That was written by Charles Hatton Spurgeon many years ago, and it's as true today that anyone who says, "I confess that I have sinned," and ask God to forgive them, will at that point be forgiven. And that's all it takes. It just takes that simple prayer. That simple prayer. So sometimes we don't have that because we've not come into that experience. Other times it's forgetfulness. I don't know about you, but I have often forgotten how faithful God has been to me. I've often got into a kind of a panic about things. Have you ever done that? And when something's happened and you think, oh my goodness, and you kind of panic and fret about it, and then you suddenly realize this happened 10 years ago and I'm still here. You know, we forget. And we look at Jesus' disciples and we look at them in the boat and we say, oh, come on, guys, get a grip. You've seen all the things that Jesus has done. And if you look back over the first few chapters of Mark's gospel, you see some amazing things that Jesus has done. And they've seen this quite recently. So for example, in Mark 1:21, Jesus casts out an unclean spirit. And at this time, four of the fishermen had been called to be Jesus' disciples. There were Simon and Andrew, and there was also James and John. And when Jesus cast out the unclean spirit, and the man was made whole, it says that they were all amazed. So these four fishermen had seen this, and they were amazed. And they said, "What is this?" And his fame spread. So they saw this happening. They also saw in Mark chapter 2, verse 1 and following, Jesus healing a paralytic. You know the one where he comes down through the roof because he can't get them in because of the big crowd. These four fishermen, who were Jesus' disciples, they actually saw this. They saw the massive crowd coming. They saw the guy coming in through the roof. They were with Jesus. And that's the one where Jesus said, you know, is it easier to say your sins are forgiven or to arise, take up your bed and walk? Because the Pharisees were present and they weren't keen on this kind of thing. And it says, immediately this man arose and took up his bed and went into the presence of them all, so that they were all amazed. So they saw this, and they'd seen this a few days before the storm. And they glorified God, everyone saying, "We have never seen anything like this before." You see? And then if you go on again, this is booming a wee bit. This is, there's a me maybe. Yep, thank you. He then heals on the Sabbath, which is, you know, really pushing it out there, wasn't it in those days? And again, he goes to the synagogue, and Jesus gets very annoyed with the Pharisees because he's going to heal on the Sabbath, and he says to the man, "Stretch out your hand." Okay, so they saw that, and that must have been amazing. And then, if you think about it, they then come, you know, through some times of teaching, and then they end up in the boat. And they'd forgotten. Why? Because fear gripped their hearts. And I think what we have to do sometimes in the life of faith is just take a minute, just stop, and don't panic. You know, just stop, have a think about things, take a few deep breaths. A prayer often doesn't go amiss, and then think about the way forward. Ask God for his perspective. Just recalibrate our thinking. And the remedy for this is to remember that God is always faithful. No matter what happens, God is always faithful. And when we do end up in a difficult situation, to go to God and to ask God for help. Because he has always been faithful to his people. And if you look at the book of Lamentations, it's one that we know well, this verse. It's in 3:23. The people of God were in a dreadful situation. But Jeremiah writes, through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed. In the storm, in the boat, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. Have you heard of compassion fatigue? With all the hassle in the world, people are fed up with charities asking for money. There's compassion fatigue. But our God, his compassion never fails. Isn't that good? God's compassion never fails. My compassion fails because I get tired and fed up sometimes. And it says something even better than that. It then goes on to say, they are new every morning, God's mercies and his compassions. And God's faithfulness is great. And my soul can say, the Lord is my portion, therefore my hope is in him. So when we do forget about God's faithfulness, maybe just to bring that verse to mind, maybe to have it somewhere, maybe have a wee sticker in your Bible and go and look at that verse, Lamentations 3:22. That's a good remedy for that. The other situation, the other reason that we sometimes forget, we sometimes panic and we have no faith and we're fearful, is because we've not been in this situation before. Now, it may have been that the disciples may have been and forgot it, or they maybe never had experienced a storm like this so far out. We don't know. But very often, we, in the lives we lead, because we do live quite a long time, you know, people say life's short. Life is, you know, short enough, but you do go through a lot of experiences. And most of us experience new things on a reasonably frequent basis. You know, a new job, a new university course, you know, getting married, having children, having grandchildren, yeah, all these sorts of things. Going somewhere new on holiday, even, you know, getting through an airport. That can be a stress, can't it? Yeah. That causes real panic. Are we going to the right place? Yeah, and all that kind of thing. Yeah, you end up in Malaga and you're luggage is in Tenerife. That's not great. But anyway, but what we have to understand about this is when we go into the situation that we're going into, that God is already there. So in that new job or the new university course or the new apprenticeship or whatever, God's there and God knows what the first day of that job or university course or holiday is going to be like. Why? Because he knew about it before the world ever began. So God's already there. So therefore, we can take confidence that although this is a situation that is new to us, it's certainly not new to God. And God knows that how we will get on in that day. And I suppose that should encourage us to pray our way into that situation. And, you know, I think sometimes we do as Christians, we lack that kind of holy boldness, that boldness to say, you know, this is going to be a good day. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This day will be good, despite what's going to happen. Despite there may be a storm, despite something unexpected may come, there may be unexpected news, which may be quite negative. But we can say that we have boldness. And the writer to the Hebrew tells us that we have boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us through the veil that is his flesh. And we are to approach the throne of God with boldness because of the blood of Christ that was shed for us. Some other times we do end up, we don't have faith because we end up with regret and we end up feeling defeated because we feel so sorry for ourselves with inside ourselves, don't we? And I'm just going to play a little song just now. Hopefully that will be able to be played. And I just wanted to just look at the words, please.
regret. I'm pretty sure we have met every single day of your life. I'm the whisper inside that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again till you've lost all belief. Oh, these are the voices. Oh, these are the lies. And I have believed them for the very last time. Hello, my name.
I like the verse that we're not defined, or the statement, we're not defined by the wreckage that's been behind. Because before we're Christians, and even when we become Christians, we do mess up significantly, don't we, sometimes, to be honest. But we're not defined by that. And we all make mistakes, no matter what we do within the church. You know, whether we're an elder or a deacon or a member of the church, an adherent, or we come now and again, we're all prone to making mistakes, you know, particularly if we're tired or upset or whatever. And God understands that. You know, I think sometimes we as Christians, we can be very harsh on each other because we all make mistakes. And if you look at Psalm 107, you see there people who actually got themselves into a situation that was difficult through their own deliberate fault. And that's what Spurgeon was talking about a wee while ago when I was quoting him. You know, those people have deliberately sinned and done things deliberately wrong. And if we just take one of the examples. There's a few examples given in Psalm 107, but if you go to Psalm 107 and verse 17, it tells us this. And remember, these were God's children. These were the children of Israel. These were God's people. So they had, inverted commas, faith. Some were fools through their sinful ways, and because of their iniquities suffered affliction. They loathed any kind of food, and they drew near to the gates of death. So that was due to their own sinful ways. So you would say, oh, well, it's over now, isn't it? But what does Lamentations tell us? What did Jeremiah find out? That God's compassions fail not, and they're new every morning. So what did these people of God do? And it's mentioned three or four times in this psalm. It tells us then in verse 18, then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love and his wondrous works to the children of man, and let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving and tell of his deeds in songs of joy. And you know, we do mess up. We do get it wrong. You know, I more than anybody probably. Maybe, you know, I probably should know more. You know, I'm older than a lot of you here, and I should know better. But, you know, I think when we do mess up, there comes a point where we have to say, right, we need to stop here. And I need to just have a think about this, and I need to get myself back on the right track. And that takes a feeling of regret, doesn't it? And sometimes we just like to bash on with the activity of life, don't we? Get up and do something else. I'll go and, you know, whatever, you know, have a game of squash. Maybe some of you don't play squash, or, you know, go for a wee run or a walk with a dog or whatever, or do something, or, you know, eat something or drink a coffee or whatever. But when that feeling of regret comes, it's important that we do take it on board, because it's God's Spirit maybe speaking to us. And regret is something that you see a lot in the Bible, don't you? A lot of people had regret. They got it wrong and they felt remorseful and they knew it. And some people handled it well, because they went God's way. They cried out to the Lord and God helped them. Others didn't go so well. The classic examples from the New Testament, of course, are the likes of Judas. When Judas realized what the 30 pieces of silver meant, that Jesus was going to be crucified, he went back to the chief priests. And he tried to get Jesus off the hook. But you see, it was regret that the Apostle Paul talks about in Corinthians. It was worldly regret. He was just looking to save his own skin, wasn't he? You know? And that's quite harsh, isn't it, to say that about someone, because we know that Judas met a dreadful end. But he I don't think he had opened himself up to Jesus and the teaching. He'd not come into that experience of being born of the Spirit. He closed his heart and he saw being part of the sort of the Jesus team and the disciples as a way to monetary gain for himself. So therefore, when the rubber hit the road, he failed in his regret. Why? Because his regret wasn't godly regret. Unlike Peter. You know, Peter loved the Lord and he was going to do really well, wasn't he? And he was just going to never let him go. And then he denies him not once, not twice, but three times. But you see, the thing about Peter was, when Peter did that, he went out and wept bitterly. And that's different. That was different. The regret that Peter felt came from God. And that's what Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians. He talks about it was godly repentance. Why? Because it led to change. And then when you see Peter on the day of Pentecost preaching, you know, he's able to say, when people say to him, what do we do, Peter? He says, repent. Why? Why does he know that? He knows it because he'd done it. And he'd been set free. And when the power of God came upon him, he's able to say, repent and be baptized. And it's an amazing sermon that Peter preaches. If you think about that, it's only within about, what, 3 or 4 months of him denying Christ, he stands up and preaches this most amazing sermon. You know, you could read this for days and see something new in it every day. And he says the most amazing thing, because they say, what do we do? And you can imagine, somewhere within Peter, he must have had some sort of shame about what he'd done. But that's the cleansing power of Jesus. Jesus can actually cleanse you so deeply by the power of his blood, he can actually take that out of your consciousness. That's the power of God. And maybe in our churches, and in my life, in your life, maybe that's something we don't have. Maybe we come to church, and I know Liam and Rab and Alan have spoken about this, mentioned this. We come to church to sing hymns and to meet people and socialize, which is great, and to hear the Bible and stuff. But maybe we don't come to meet the living God. Maybe we don't come to meet the living God. Maybe that's the thing that's missing in my life, in your life, in the life of this church, and churches across this nation, is that God doesn't turn up in the way that he used to. Because if you look at revivals of old, and I know we can get a bit nostalgic about all that, and things were different then, and people didn't have the access to the internet to check things out and be skeptical. But if you look at things like the revivals that would have happened around here in the beginning of last century, and also things like places like Wales and the Methodist revival and the Baptist revivals in places like Oxfordshire and Bedfordshire, when the people came in, God turned up in a way that nobody could walk out of that building and say they hadn't met God. They just didn't hear a gospel message, right? Because, you know, they would have heard the gospel message. But they actually met God in a deep and real way. And maybe that's something that we, as God's church, we need to crave more and more, that God would actually turn up in that same sort of way. And Peter is able to say, because he's been cleansed, he says, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. That's to what, you know, your sins are forgiven, to them taken away, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promises to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, that's us, as many as the Lord our God will call. So, you know, maybe that we need to, you know, to get closer to God. To get closer to God and to get over that sense of defeat. I think we do as a church in the nation, across the nation, particularly in Western civilization, where church attendance is dropping in many places. We feel a bit defeated. We're on the back foot. But maybe our mental attitude needs to be different. Because Peter wasn't on the back foot. Okay, when he denied Jesus, he was on the back foot. But when the power of God came upon him, he was on the front foot. And think of what he's doing. He's saying this to Jewish people. And throughout the whole of the Acts of the Apostles, when Peter and Paul and people like that are actually preaching, they're putting their lives in great danger. So they obviously had something, right, that the likes of Peter and the others didn't have in the boat. There was a big change because they'd met God in a deep and in a real way. And maybe that's what we need to have in terms of the regret and the defeat that we sometimes feel. I think also we sometimes lack faith and we're fearful because we have unforgiveness in our hearts. Now, that's a big topic in itself. I just would like to say that all churches have issues with this. All communities have issues with this. Whenever there's a group of humans together, people get offended, get upset. It happens all the time. But, you know, Jesus said, Paul writes, and, you know, Jesus says on the cross, you know, forgive them for they don't know what they do. Which when I read that, I really, really do realize how different Jesus' attitude to people is to mine. Because I would not be saying that if I'd been him, but then I wasn't the Son of God. So, but that doesn't let me off the hook, you know, because he lives in me. But when you go to Ephesians and Colossians, there's some beautiful verses that, you know, I read this afternoon and I was really... You know the way you've read something hundreds of times? You know, Paul writes this. And remember, people have tried to kill Paul numerous times. And the churches, people had fallen out with him, and there was a lot of discord, wasn't there? Quite often. And he says this, be kind to one another, tender-hearted. That's having a soft heart towards each other. Forgiving one another. And you would say, well, I'll maybe try. But then he trumps that by saying, as God in Christ forgave you. So in other words, what Paul's saying is, we forgive each other. Why? Because God forgave each of us. And Christ lives in each of us. You know? It's what Jesus talks about when he says, you know, you have to forgive other people so that God, your Father, will be able to forgive you. Because you can't receive grace unless you're going to give grace. See, Christianity is very interesting because Jesus said it's better to give than to receive. You know, there's a great power in being able to forgive someone. And my experience has been Because I can hold a grudge like anybody else, you know. Being Irish, you know, we can hold a grudge. Irish and Scots, our history tells us that, doesn't it? The Irish have killed more Irish and the Scots have killed more Scots than anybody else. We're good at that. But we can hold a grudge, you know, hundreds of years ago, this happened and that happened. But when you release that person, and they may not care, but when you release them, God does something in your heart with regard to his forgiveness of you and of me. God does something very powerful in the context of that forgiveness. And it is such an important thing in the life of any fellowship, in the life of any organization. And I suppose that would be the remedy for that. And I think at the end of the day, I suppose that the reason that my faith has quite often been in a very low ebb, and I've been full of kind of, not necessarily fear, but anxiety and a kind of a dread of things, is that I harbored sin in my life, and I still do, as we all have, because we have indwelling sin to the day we're released from it. But maybe my confession is not as deep as it should be. And to finish, just as a prayer for all of us, I just want to read this. And this is David writes, and after he'd committed adultery with Bathsheba and had her husband Uriah the Hittite killed. "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall declare your praise. For you do not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." Another way of saying that last bit is, a broken and contrite heart, God loves. And I don't know where your heart is tonight. We all have aspects of our personality and our hearts that's broken. There's sorrow in one bit and joy in another. Something's going well, our relationship's going well, our relationship's broken. We're very complex as humans. But God loves it. He loves it when we come to him and we tell him about the brokenness and the sadness that we have in our hearts, and when we tell him about our sins. But also we tell him about the good things, and we tell him the things that we're thankful for. And one of the things that I'm thankful for is this fellowship. Let's pray. God, our Father, we thank you that Jesus asked the disciples, why were they so fearful and why they had no faith on that boat when the water was washing in, and it was the most logical thing to be fearful and to doubt. And Father, we admit that we're the same. We often have fear. We often lack faith, that living faith that gives us that overcoming spirit to face life and the challenges that it brings to us. God, we ask tonight that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit, that you would just restore us, restore unto us again the joy of our salvation, and cleanse us afresh by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand to sing these last two songs. The Lord's my shepherd, I'm not want, and above all powers.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'm not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still water.
that again.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not love. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust.
Above all kingdoms,
I'll pray to finish and then read a wee psalm. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have given us faith. And we thank you that we don't have to live lives of regret and defeat. And Lord, we don't have to focus on the wreckage from the past, the things that went wrong. But we can look up and look forward to a life of hope and optimism and Jesus, our soon coming King. And Psalm 133, behold how good and pleasant it is when the people dwell together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard and on the beard of Aaron running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon which falls on the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Amen.
You have been listening to Lossiemouth Baptist Church. For more information, look at www.lossiebaptist.org.